Welcome all for the third session on Kauṭilya's Arthaśāstra, which is conducted by Institute at Chanakya International Institute of Leadership Studies, along with us, Priya. And we have two chairpersons. All of us know them. The first one is Dr. Marvi Narsili, who was a speaker in the previous session, and Dr. Adhikrishna Pillai. And Dr. Marvi Narsili has been already introduced. And I request Shubha ma'am to please come forward and felicitate Dr. Narsili. Chanakya received the Sardar Patel International Award in 2009. With nearly 20 years of combined working and business experience, he is a well-known management speaker, trainer, author and consultant. He has written nearly 200 articles and papers for various magazines, newspapers, journals and periodicals, including Times of India, Times of India Group, Mumbai Mirror, as a weekly columnist. He has also hosted a radio show. He has represented India in various national and international conferences, including the Academy of Management in San Antonio, Texas. Presented papers in Indian Philosophical Congress and chaired session at Afro-Asian Philosophical Congress, taught in Germany, Singapore and Indonesia. He has been a trainer and strategy consultant to over 200 organizations like Indian Police, various NGOs, private public sector, and government organizations including Indian Oil, HPCL, BPCL, and L&T. Further, I request Madhvi ma'am to, now we have three speakers, and I request Madhvi ma'am to facilitate Dr. Subhash Sharma, please. Director of Indian Institute of Plantation Management, Bangalore, and founding member of India's Business Academy and is currently director at IBA Bangalore. Professor Subhash Sharma is also recipient of Excellence Achievement and Leadership Award for his creative contributions and institution building. Over to Dr. Sharma, sir.
Dr. Sharma, sir, started as chairperson, myself and others. This is that being the last session, and we also have to wind up in time, but we also want to keep a discussion on. So, the way we are looking at that, when the three experts will be presenting their papers, whatever questions you have, you can just write it down, and maximum towards the end, we will moderate those questions and summarize the whole thing. So, please keep your questions ready, and we'll have this 20 minutes presentation of each scholars and discussion. Towards.
Thank you very much. It's really an honor to be here. Thank you, chairpersons. Another question is known to me in the last 20 years. The theme which I have chosen is what I call Kauṭilya to Modi, governance models of India. The simple question which I ask myself is that are there any governance models? And what are those governance norms? Is there a change? Is there a continuity? So what is that change and what is that continuity? So we need to have this very simple question to ourselves. What are those governance models from India which we can globalize in the 21st century? So that was a simple question and which led me to exploring these ideas. So I have identified three: the Kauṭilya's governance model, and then the Gandhi's governance model, and then the Modi's governance model. What are the basic conceptual differences? What are their characteristics? And what is unique about each one of them? And my intellectual linkage with these three ideas is right, I think, from 1994, when I published this article on Kauṭilya's Arthaśāstra from a managerial perspective. So I'm going to take the managerial perspective. We have all seen the political side, diplomatic side, defense side, and many other sides. Though the managerial perspective was mentioned, but I think we need to explore it in much more greater detail. So those scholars who are interested in management and leadership, we have probably referred to this Indian Journal of Public Administration article. And then the Gandhi's model of governance is in one of my papers, which is titled as Corporate Shubh Labh. This is also available at the academia.edu and the research gate. So you can easily download and read them. And my own interest in Modi's model started long time back, perhaps at a time when nobody was thinking about it. That was 2005, nobody thought about the idea of the Modi's governance model. In my talk at South Gujarat University, I was trying to conceptualize that model and what I call the holistic globalization, the idea of harmonic globalization. If time permits, I will talk about it in more greater detail. So, let's look at them one by one. And I will use this criteria of what I call the context and the key ideas and the, what is the underlying thought or philosophy. So that is my framework, which I also call it as the thought, theory and the practice, the TTP. So I look at the model from the angle of the thought and the angle of the theory and the angle of the practice. So now what is the context of the Kauṭilya's governance model? So context, it was managing a kingdom. So let's be very clear that it was the context of managing a kingdom. That time the kingdom was the organizing entity in almost every society. Key ideas: strong kingdom, enlightened king. and the happy Praja. So when I study Kautilya's Arthaśāstra from a management angle, I find these are the key ideas, and rest, in my opinion, is a matter of detailing it out. How do we outline the systems and procedures and the Sartan model and those kinds of things are the detailing of these three key ideas. And the underlying philosophy, as we have seen, was basically the idea of the freedom, the dharma, and of course the moksha was there, but silently. But as we learn from Arthaśāstra, the moksha was the, for the people who want to explore that path. But as far as King is concerned, his ideas are very clear that these are the three things which he is beginning to take into consideration. Now, what are the kind of a contemporary relevance of that? The contemporary relevance is, again, the strong nation concept. And then the enlightened leadership. And then the happy citizens. So these are the three key contemporary ideas which we learn from Arthaśāstra. Corporate context, of course, Radhakrishnan has written full book. And a lot of work has been done. So again, strong corporates. Enlightened scene. That's the problem of the corporate world today. The corporate world, the enlightened CEOs are missing. And that's the reason. That's the cause of corruption and many other problems which you see in the corporate world. And the third is the happy statements. Again, there is a problem with the corporate world because the focus has been mostly on the shareholders. Only recently the focus has shifted the stakeholders. So how do you create that happiness among all the stakeholders? What are the parameters on which you measure that? So there is a lot of work to be done if you have to learn from the Kauṭilya's Arthaśāstra and what are lessons for the corporate world. Now I come to Gandhi's governance model. Again, what is the context? Now the context changed from the kingdom to the liberation of a nation. So the whole context was changed. Now, what do you do to the context of a liberation of a nation? So therefore, what were the three key ideas? So the Swaraj as a basic idea. Self-discipline, nijpa-sashan, fir anushasan, that is the kind of a concept. And then the maryada model of governance, management, leadership and governance. That's the vision of the Ram Rajya. So those were the three simple key ideas. And again, as I said, that is a matter of details. And what was the underlying thought and philosophy? Again, Ram Rajya. And I have reformulated the idea of Ram Rajya in a contemporary context, and I call it as a vision of the sacro-civic society. Sacro-civic society. Not just a civic society, that's a Western model. In the Western model of civic society, the sacro dimension is missing. So we need to have the new idea of the sacro-civic society. So sacro represents the Ram concept, and civic represents the Rajya concept. So you get a new phrase, new terminology, and a new thought or a new underlying philosophy. Now what is the application in contemporary context? So national context, the vision of Ram Rajya, which is beyond the idea of socialism and capitalism, is a different matter that in 1947, when we got liberated, we rejected the idea of Ram Rajya and we went for the idea of socialism. And then in 1991, we rejected socialism and then went for the so-called LPG or the variation of the capitalism. So, fundamentally we have taken a wrong path. We have not understood the deeper ideas behind our own indigenous thought. And we borrowed the ideas which happened to be very popular at that point in time. and we applied the wrong solution, like he was mentioning about the solutions, was the appropriate solution. So at that point in time, you ended up applying the wrong solution, and then the solution continued for 40, 50 years, and then we realized now there are some problems with the solution. So what should we do? So fix up with another solution, but within the same paradigm. See, this is the problem we have. We are searching for solutions, but then we search for solution within the same paradigm. We are not breaking the paradigm. What is the application in corporate context? So good corporate governance, the transmission model of corporations, Ram-like corporate leaders, the enlightened leaders, and the corporate Ram-like, which means no corruption. So, can we create that corporate Ram-Rajya of no corruption? So, those are the contemporary lessons which we have from Gandhi's concept of governance. Now we come to Modi's model of governance, and what is the uniqueness about that? Again, the context changed. It is no more the liberation of a nation, where the energies can be completely channelized into that. Now it is a totally different context. The context of development of a nation. How do we develop a nation which has already faced so many problems for the last 70 years? And that vision was never clear, but what is to be done? Is there an underlying philosophy? What is that philosophy? And so what was the key idea which Gandhi, which Modi has given? And that key phrase which has come is Sabka Saath, Sabka Saath. Now, how it is different from the earlier models? How it is different from the socialism and capitalism? Because both socialism and capitalism are not holistic approaches. There is no holistic philosophy behind it. It's limited. It comes from a very, very segmented view of the human beings and the human society. So intuitively, Modi has derived this phrase, which is Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas. And now we are, when I look at it as a management and a leadership student, I find that it is a very, very, very breakthrough idea, which is trying to find out a solution in a new paradigm rather than the olden Western paradigm. And how he's trying to implement some of these things is the Man Ki Baat. Again, look at that phrase, it is the heart dimension, not just the head dimension. Both socialism and capitalism have originated from the head dimension of thinking, and the heart dimension is missing. So in Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas, the head and heart go together, intuitive. And then the reach out model, which was missing in the Indian thought, though it is there in ancient times, but its articulation in contemporary language was missing. So that's connectivity with the people. So connectivity with the people is the key, one of the key ideas also from Arthasastra. And then the new alignments. We went for non-alignment philosophy at a political level. And then what we find is, again, a paradigm shift in terms of new elements. Again, Kautilya's ideas are getting reflected into that. It's a dynamic situation. You need to continuously explore the new ideas, new elements. And what is the underlying philosophy? Again, the underlying philosophy is Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Sankhina. So it has come, the Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas idea has come from that kind of a thought process. So there is a change and there is a continue. So then, how do we apply this? Now I have applied it in my own way, being a management person. So I will put it as a India model. Three pillars of the India model. First is nationalism. Second is development. Third is aspiration. Nationalism, development and aspiration. These are the three basic pillars. Now, nationalism, I have a very simple management perspective again in nationalism, which is missing. Because so far you have the territorial perspective, you have the constitutional perspective, you have the cultural perspective. And there is always five, as we know. But then there is a fourth perspective, which I say, that is the nation building perspective. How do we channelize the energies of people in a very positive manner and use it constructively? Now that is the idea of nationalism, which is missing in the nationalist literature. And I think we need to work in that direction. So that is the nationalism part of it. Development, holistic. Not socialistic, not capitalistic, but holistic. And aspiration. So we need to articulate those aspirations. That's why my analysis of the word India becomes Indian nationalism, development and international aspiration. So that becomes a kind of a new vision, the vision of the new India. I'm only articulating both these ideas into a catchphrase, because you also need, in philosophy, you also need some catchphrases so that, you know, the ideas can be communicated to masses. Okay, anyway, this I have already mentioned. How do I define nationalism? So I'm not going into details of that. So, international aspiration, I call it global connectivity. Nation and the global connectivity. Not globalization, but global connectivity. There is a subtle difference. The way I look at this idea of globalization, it is from the viewpoint of global connectivity. So that means nation and the earth have to be connected. So nation and the earth connectivity means the Bharat Mata and the Bhu Mata connectivity has to be clear in our mind. Mother Earth and the Mother India connectivity. So how do we finally integrate Kautilya, Gandhi, Modi and everybody? For this I have got this four lines metaphor. The four lines represent, according to me, four forces, force of market on one side, force of state on the other side, force of people, or I also call it as capillary action, grassroots up, and then the force of self, spiritual, which has been missing in the Western thought process. So when you put these four forces together, you get this swastika, the x-axis and the y-axis. X-axis you have the market and the state. Y-axis, you have the people and self, spiritual dimension. If swastika is rotating properly, there is harmony. If swastika is out of balance, there is disorder and disharmony. So today, that is the problem with the world. And in the Western thought philosophy, is, you know, there is an over-focus on X-axis. Market state, capitalism, communism, or socialism. And there is no Y-axis. Y-axis articulation is missing completely. So for that Y-axis articulation, another way of putting it is that it is the soil and soul axis. Now in Western thinking, again, being too much focused on the X-axis, all philosopher, the entire leftist rightist discourse in the economics is centered around the X-axis only. If you read today in newspapers, you will find that gives an analysis of society only from that angle. Y-axis analysis has been missing. So we need to bring in that dimension. So this is what I call, on the other side, it is Adam Smith and Marx, X-axis, and Gandhi and Vivekananda on the Y-axis. So then only you get a very holistic picture, otherwise you don't get a holistic picture. So this leads us to what I call the new Arthasastra. New Arthasastra. So this becomes a basic philosophy for the idea of the new Arthasastra. So the swastika model creates a philosophical foundation, and I think it's not only applicable to India, probably we can offer it to the whole globe, and everybody can And so this is the final model of how do I integrate. When I said self, self is reflected in terms of what I call who. Higher order purpose of existence. Now that is a basic question only Indian thinkers have been asking over so many centuries. What is the higher order purpose of existence? Is there any higher order purpose of existence? No other philosophers have asked so clearly. So that is the idea which we need to again ask every time. And then if that hope is clear in our mind, which of course is mentioned is through the purushartha, you know, concept in our tradition. And then on the other, one side we have the corporates, on the other side we have the government. So corporates, CSR, corporate social responsibility as an idea. And I have proposed a CSD, corporate social dharma, which is more than just corporate social responsibility. And on this side, the good governance for the government. And then on the capital reaction, the, how will you give push to the social entrepreneurship, social dimension. So that becomes a complete model for India and also the rest of the world. Thank you very much, and we'll discuss it further. I thought I will leave some thoughts with you.
And just to mention that Subhash Sharma ji's works have been even referred in many Supreme Court judgments. The study of the Arthaśāstra has been very phenomenal. Some of his books, as I told you, have been referred nationally and internationally, including Supreme Court judgments. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Our next speaker is Dr. Priya, Vaidya. And her topic is Essential Dimensions of Enlightened Leadership with special reference to Kauṭilya's Arthaśāstra. And a brief intro about Dr. Priya ma'am. She has done PhD in Philosophy of Education according to Swami Vivekananda and Sri Aurobindo under the guidance of our Dr. Shubhda ma'am. She is Assistant Professor at Department of Philosophy in our university, that's the University of Mumbai. She is visiting faculty at Chanakya International Institute of Leadership Studies. She has published more than 20 research papers and presented more than 30 papers. She has designed and conducted more than 30 workshops, and she has authored a book titled Swami Vivekananda, Practices of Education. And over to Dr. Priya.
Thank you, Chetan, for kind words. Respected teachers, my friends, and dear students. At the onset, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to present this paper. This is a joint paper, first joint paper with my teacher, Dr. Shubhda Joshi ma'am, and I'm grateful for her suggestions and the inputs. So I just want to say at the beginning, the best part which would emerge from this paper is hers, and that which remains would be mine. What I have tried to do is, I have tried to focus on the application part of Chanakya's thoughts. And so this paper is going to be an application-based paper for two reasons. A, because over the 2 days, we are going to discuss about Kauṭilya's philosophy. So I thought that the application dimension would be more fitting. And second, after the seminar, what? So I thought that if we are able to look at the application dimension of the paper, something from this seminar would follow. Uh, The objective of the paper is to establish the relevance of enlightened leadership with reference to Kauṭilya's Arthaśāstra. And the second objective is to need to design a training program on the aspect of enlightened leadership for teachers. I'm sure you have this question, why teachers, and I also have an answer because I happen to be a teacher. I thought that this particular training is required, and why it is required, whether really it is required, I think over the 15 minutes this would get clear. So once upon a time in a classroom, a teacher gave an essay to the students to write, and the topic was on truth. And the best essay was written by the biggest liar in the class. Now you can imagine, the task for teacher is not just to teach, but to visit, to understand what really happens in a classroom setup. And thus in a classroom setup is a need for an enlightened leader. And thus, this is just one of the problems which I have tried to say, that I don't even look at it as a problem, but it is something which we wouldn't have even imagined. So what I have tried to do is, I have made a grid. This is, I have myself tagged it as Enlightened Leadership Grid. This grid is divided into three dimensions. As you can see, it is knowing oneself, knowing the world, and knowing the world and knowing the beyond. So when we look at the enlightened leadership dimension as viewed by Kauṭilya, these are tried to classify into knowing oneself, critical reasoning, development of psycho-spiritual realm, knowing the other, that is the duty-centric approach, knowing the world, that is the essence of the empirical, vision to create wealth, rules and relevance, and knowing beyond, where I have tried to look at knowledge and wisdom dimension. I would deliberate upon those aspects in my following slides. Why this program? I felt this program should be designed because there is an ancient modern connect which is necessary. There is a need for a training program based on Indian thought in India, because when I did the research and some kind of a literature review, and as a part of teacher, the training programs which I have undergone myself when I was trained, I did not see the Indian dimension in the training program, and I thus felt that there is a need, and this is just an attempt. For whom this program? This program is for teachers. But when I sat to design this program, there can be n number of programs which can be designed for different groups of people. Let me tell you, while I designed the program, general program for teachers, I designed the dimensions of teachers in the general category for slow learners, for pre-primary. There are almost 15 programs which can be generated on the enlightened leadership idea. One idea can bring about these many training programs. The point is not to develop training programs, but the point is through it will reach maximum people. And what will be the benefit of the program? This is a very cliched question, I know that what will the benefit be? Fayda ye hoga ki when we look at the our students as a workforce, when you look into the industry, many of the corporate sector, when I interact, they say that they have to be again trained. They are not ready for the responsibility and all that. So I think if this training happens in schools and colleges, that they will be a very solid workforce. Plus, we do not just need an economic dimension. We need, as sir was also mentioning, for nation building. We just don't want to celebrate Independence Day, but we want something of all this to be done for the nation, so the social realm will be there. And the spiritual, which I think we all agree that if we are happy with ourselves, we will be happy in the society we live. So, I'll quickly run through the seven dimensions of critical reasoning, which Kauṭilya reflects on the dimension of discriminative knowledge. There are many dimensions, but here I am taking one where this critical reasoning is for knowing what is right and wrong. Let me tell you, when one is a teacher, we also get into the role of telling others what is right and wrong. But I myself feel here there is a need to look within and ask whether what we are doing is right or what we are doing is wrong. Because if you may note, in India, the dropout rates are low. One of the reasons may be poverty, but one more reason is fear to get into the classroom. There are teachers who are not able to communicate, there are teachers who are not able to establish that understanding between the students. So if we are having this critical reasoning with our own self, the processes and the methods and the content which we use, I think what Kauṭilya is trying to say, we are trying to look at it from a deeper angle, and this would perhaps make it more interesting. When you look at the knowledge, wisdom, synthesis and its significance, in our system of education, we try to make students so equipped with knowledge that they get good degrees. But information, knowledge, but transformation doesn't take place. Innovation doesn't take place. Wisdom realm is always questioned with how is it going to help, in what form. So we are not actually developing wisdom entrepreneurs. And if we are able to develop wisdom entrepreneurs, which I think Kauṭilya is trying to indicate, there would be a lot of creativity and people would be more happy and copy pasting would be avoided. Many, you know, there is nothing for which it's a sin. When you are not able to tell the child to be creative, I think the teachers themselves have to focus on the wisdom realm, and the training program which I am trying to focus is a journey from information to knowledge and from knowledge to information. I was able to get this from the Google image because I wanted this image to convey something which is very abstract, the psycho-spiritual realm. Now, when you look at Kauṭilya's dimension of the psycho-spiritual realm, one of the dimension is that indriya jaya. For example, when we talk about the enemies, when we talk about, say, for example, anger, I'm sure if some of you are teachers here, if you enter a class of 120 students, typically, and if you have to enter that four times in a day with a teenager group, the control which is required, I think the psycho-spiritual realm becomes the most important. I still remember my first lecture when I started with teaching, where I could listen to animal sounds in the class and I did not know what to do. Because I was not trained, I did not know whether I should get angry, leave the class, and I just handled the situation by the way. But if that would have been a setback, I would have left teaching. So I'm just trying to say this is one dimension of it, that the psycho-spiritual realm, where we are talking about speech impurities or the need for sense training, yoga training. As sense training, as teachers we like to talk, but as teachers we should also learn to listen. So listening as a skill has also to be developed, and so when Kauṭilya is talking about the different enemies which are within, if the impurities are erased, I think the sattva dimension in the teacher would emerge. And if that emerges, I think love would be more easily possible in classrooms. And so, then there is the essence of the empirical. When we talk about the empirical, I really was very happy that the empirical is not lost in the spiritual realm. So when we talk about teachers, when we talk about training given to teachers, generally the training is with regard to subjects. or we are very comfortable in our classrooms talking about concepts. For example, there are so many accidents which take place. There are so many sad things which take place in the city. Do we sensitize our students to become more humane beings? So empirical is essential, and can we connect that to teaching? Can we connect it to value-based learning? And if we try to reflect upon Kautilya's dimension, I think this can be possible. So this is, I can, but I won't. Because I have limited timing, I have many things to do which are very personal, and I have to get going. If I start walking that extra mile, I will not get my time. If you are able to see that there are many teachers who walk that extra mile anyway, but there are many who do not walk. If you are able to reflect on this duty-centric dimension, I think a teacher can be a role model for the students, because when we talk about duty-centric aspect, we are trying to look at that dimension of sattva again, which is reflective. So Kauṭilya speaks about a vision to create wealth. Our classrooms are actually, there's so much wealth there, that there are so many ideas there, and there are these ideas which can be properly taken up. A lot of creation can be done, and lot of inspiration and love can be given so that we have better tomorrow, not just for the people of this country, but for themselves. There are many students who don't feel like going to schools because they are not interested in that entire setup. Now when we look at this vision to create wealth, this wealth is something intangible wealth. If you are not able to do anything, but at least able to help them to appreciate what is life, I think that's it. If you are able to develop that in a dimension which is familiar to them and not of something which they cannot connect, I think this can be done. He talks about rules, he talks about the dimension, but with rules there is wisdom dimension also. So when a teacher is reflecting on the rules, every time a teacher cannot go by the rule book. And these rules have to be, they are necessary, but the rules have to be focused with more of softness, not just for punishing and getting ready to punish each and every person. More about this is in our paper, and try to focus on this, we have tried to reflect on this model. The question is, who will conduct this? And my answer is, anybody who's sitting here and will be sitting here for 2 days and has this love for what you're learning. This doesn't require much of money, investment. You can walk to any school which is near to your house. This can be ideally a 6 months program. I've just taken a dimension, and I'm just trying to say this is not a perfect program also. It can be tailored as per the need of so many BMC schools or so many private schools. This is not also a program for teachers only. This is a program for parents also. So this is how, what are the limitations of this program? The limitations are, if you don't focus on Kauṭilya's thoughts, if you don't understand the pulse of the students, this program will totally fail. Another question which can come to me, I'm assuming that, can we make this program a global program? Definitely. But let us first make it local, move to national, and then guide others once we have this experience. I would like to close my the presentation with a small story. Some of you may feel like doing or feeling like, you may be feeling like designing some more programs like this. And some of you may ask a very cynical question, what difference will this make? So there was a boy who was playing by the sea and trying to collect fishes which came through the waves. As the fishes came, the boy would again put it in the water. And he was doing it for many times. So there was an elderly person who said, what are you doing? What difference will it make to you? You have to go home. So the little child smiled and said, I know it wouldn't make any difference to me, but it will certainly make some difference to every fish I'm putting it in the water. So my dear friends, I think that difference we have to do, and the time has come now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Priya. Just for all the other scholars, Priya ma'am is a very popular teacher within our course. She teaches transformational leadership. And I think what's very important is that Kauṭilya was a teacher, and here we're looking at more Kauṭilyas to be created. So it's almost like train the trainers or teach the teachers. I'm sure the insights from this will be useful for all people in the teaching profession and who would like to be teachers in their own respective fields. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. This reminds me of Chanakya's quote, Shikshak kabhi sadharan nahi hota, Hriday aur Nirman uske gud mein padte. You learn from sir also. And the third speaker. The third speaker is Dr. Namita Nimbalkar. Her topic is tracing the roots of environmental concern in Kauṭilya's Arthaśāstra. And a brief introduction about Dr. Namita. She's an assistant professor in the Department of Philosophy in the University of Mumbai. She has taught at Birla College Kalyan for 15 years. Her PhD focused on Gandhian philosophy. She specializes in contemporary philosophy, Indian and environmental ethics. She is invited at various national and international seminars, conferences to give talks on Gandhian philosophy. She has published in several national and international academic journals in the context of Gandhian philosophy and environmental ethics. She is conferred the prestigious Hera Tata Fellowship 2015-16 for her postdoctoral work on culture and travel, the differing perspectives of M.K. Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore. She has recently published a book titled Gandhi's Quest for Religion and Communal Harmony. Over to Dr. Namita Nimbalkar.
Thank you, the guys. Dr. Shubhra Joshi, madam, teachers present over here, and all friends. This will be my first attempt to talk about Kauṭilya, and I do hope that I'll succeed in it. Of course, I'm taking an environmental perspective towards it. The reason for this is that United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, and in its most recent report, it has warned the effects of global warming, which will take place on food prices, and none of us are away from it. We experience it on a daily basis when our wives or our mothers or daughters or sisters or whosoever put the food on the plate, on the table, and they keep quoting the amount of price which we have to shell out to buy the vegetables. So it's the food prices, and again also on the national security, and of course on the environment. It also warns about the production of vital food crops such as rice, maize and wheat, not to increase, but all these things, the production of it will drop down by 2015, and the resultant of it would be domestic violence, migration, poverty, and conflict. If you look at Syria, which is facing so much of havoc, so it's not only about the ISIS which is playing an important role in it, but then there are various other climatic factors too, which have contributed to conflict in such areas. The report also cautions of extreme weather, which will become more frequent and affect a large number of people in Asia, Europe and Africa. The IPCC report underlines the fact that the technological advancement has made us as the biggest consumers, reproducers and of course garbage makers. And if leaders of the world do not step in, it is almost certain that we will trample not only on the rights of the present generation but also of the future. It brings a chilling revelation that ecological collapse no longer merely threatens, we are well into it. It is an urgent need to convince people to consume, reproduce and waste less. The big question is, how to squeeze ourselves out of the net of environmental degradation which we ourselves have over it? The obvious answer is, we are the cause of problem, so we are going to be a large part of the solution. The Industrial Revolution resulted in indiscriminate use of natural resources, creating pressure on the biotic and abiotic world. The growing concern resulted in a specific study which gave rise to environmental ethics as a new discipline of philosophy in the early 1970s. Environmental ethics challenges the anthropocentric or human-centered view, which assumes moral superiority of human beings to members of other species on Earth. Different theories such as biocentric, ecofeminism, animal rights are put forth to understand and provide solutions to environmental issues. However, though the theories help us to understand the issues well, yet we need to remember that apart from the Western perspective, we have traditional wisdom which will aid in making citizens aware of their responsibilities towards environment. The religious hermeneutical lens seeks to answer from the scriptures, texts, rituals and myths. O.P. Dwivedi in his Dharmic Ecology paper looks at religion as a strategy that puts into practice the Hindu concept of eco-care. A very brief summary of different religious scriptures, I will be making it. In the Indian context, we have rich storehouse of vast literary and philosophical texts, the teachings of which can play an important role in making people play proactive role in environmental protection. In the framework of the text of Vedas, Upanishads, we come across reference and concern for environment and its beings. The text accords some moral significance to other creatures and proposes some ethical responsibilities on the part of humans, although these ethical dimensions are usually secondary or inferior relative to responsibilities to other humans. In sharp contrast to the anthropocentric view of the West, the texts elevate nature to sacred position. The Vedas, Upanishads, Mahabharata, Ramayana and the Puranas contain messages encouraging the protection of the environment and inspire a sense of respect for nature. The Manusmriti, for example, prohibits wanton destruction of both wild and cultivated plants. It further emphasizes that violence against domesticated animals is equivalent to hinsa. Reference can be made to Manusmriti of 5.38, which states, a person who kills an animal for meat will die of a violent death as many times as there are hairs on that killed animal. The Yajnavalkya Smriti, which is there, verse 180, warns of hellfire of Ghor Narka on those who kill domesticated and protected animals. It says, the wicked person who kills animals which are protected has to live in hellfire for the days equal to the number of hairs on the body of that animal. Sacred texts emphasize that nature is not to be conquered.
Humans are to live in harmony with nature and recognize that the divinity resides in all living elements, including plants and animals. Certain texts of the ancient ages, they gave us insights to the role and duties of the administrator or the king in the governance of a nation. Almost all the decisions related to the development of a nation, be it construction of roads, dams, settling of museum and population, be it reservation of forest and agricultural land, setting up of factories, etc., has to take place in the context of the natural environment that is biotic and abiotic. The text gives interesting insight into how the administrators, while taking decisions on developmental projects, situates environment in the entire context. Though environment was not a concern as great as it is today, yet the small peek into the text help us to know the status according to nature. Now I come to the next part, and that is Kauṭilya and environmental ethics. Kauṭilya's Arthaśāstra is the greatest Indian treatise on the art of governance and administration, the duties of kings, ministers, officials, the art of diplomacy, etc. Kauṭilya defines Arthaśāstra as a science dealing with the means of acquiring and protecting the earth inhabited by man. This definition, by its implication, covers a wide range of activities of the state. Arthaśāstra claims that man exists because of earth, the earth, which is inhabited by men. This earth is a good source of other arthas, namely gold, grain, cattle, goods, and other comforts of life. The source of livelihood are three, that is agriculture, cattle breeding, and trade. Acquisition and development of these sources in Arthaśāstra points to the value accorded to nature. A distinctive aspect of Kauṭilya's ethical thinking is that it is political. It concerns not only what is good for an individual, but also for a community. There is a shift in and an expansion of the ethical perspective of environment in the Arthaśāstra, where sacredness is not ascribed to nature, but nature and its resources are looked upon as a source of revenue generation, commodities to be made and sold in the market, and the control and supervision of the administrator over the natural resources. The Arthaśāstra deals with attainment and preservation of the three sciences, namely Anushki, that is philosophy, Vedashri, and economics. From a micro perspective of economics, we can safely say that it deals with human beings, use of resources, production, consumption, and distribution of goods. It then becomes interesting to know how Kauṭilya views the natural resources. Indeed, we find that Arthaśāstra tradition borrows more or less from the epistemology of the Lokayata. The resulting emphasis is laid on the here and now rather than on the hereafter. Though it is observed that the text is about governance and there are comparisons drawn between Kauṭilya and Vaidya, integrity of character, self-discipline is virtue which is emphasized in the Arthaśāstra. Self-restraint helps an individual to not to fall to the temptation of the senses and excesses which is much needed both by an individual consumer and the community at large, both in the yesteryear and today. The maintenance of social order needed both dharma, that is performance of the assigned duties, and danda, that is punishment and the use of coercive power against errors. Kauṭilya believes that evil is inherent in man and danda makes him righteous. Though he also insists that it is dharma which guarantees stability to the social order. Care towards environment and people inhabiting it is reflected in the Arthaśāstra when Kauṭilya lays down rules for town planning and specific instructions are given for the construction of a village with number of families specified in each village along with its agriculture people. The significance of situating human beings among proper environment is stressed wherein Kauṭilya states that villages will have boundaries which shall be denoted by a river or a mountain, forest, or we talk about the different types of plants, caves, artificial buildings, or by trees. The importance of construction of reservoir that is the setu, to meet the requirements of the farmer people is also emphasized. The text also mentions that reservoirs should be filled with water, either perennial or drawn from other sources that should be constructed. Good governance is when the ruler provides with sites, roads, temples, and timber and other necessary things for those who construct reservoirs for their own record. Likewise is the construction of places of pilgrimage and of groves. We are well aware that sacred groves in the present context are playing an important role. When we look at Africa, we look in India, we look in Mongolia, we are aware about the importance of the sacred grove where they are becoming an important part in environmental conservation. Kauṭilya emphasizes on the preservation of sacred groves. Chanakya, by emphasizing on the construction of the sacred groves, implicitly implies the protection of animals, birds and different kinds of forest produce. Environmental ethics as a discipline in its purview is not anthropocentric, but also concerns itself with natural habitat and animal rights. In the Arthaśāstra, complete right of ownership is given to the king with regard to fishing, farming and trading in vegetables in reservoirs or lakes. On close analysis, we find that natural resources were brought under state control, not only for revenue generation, but also these activities like fishing could be carried out only by the permission of the administrator, which would assist to conserve and preserve marine life. The Arthashastra mentions seven important sources for the collection of revenue. This collection of revenues are from forts, country parts, mines, buildings and garden, forest, herds of cattle and road of traffic. Flower gardens, fruit gardens, vegetable garden, wet fields and the fields where crops are grown by sowing roots for seeds come under sale. Cows, buffaloes, goats, sheep, asses, camels, horses and mules, they come under the category of herds. Much of the economy was dependent on the use of resources which were bountiful in nature. The Arthashastra also makes land classification and it also deals with forest planning, specifically with regard to elephant forest and pastures in some detail. Kauṭilya ensures that pastures are to be planted in uncultivated land and for the use of cattle. It is the Arthashastra of Kauṭilya which gives full recognition to the significance of forest in the economy of the state. Kauṭilya divides forest into categories. He mentions that game forest, timber forest and elephant forest are forest. The demarcation becomes important as the forest were also a place of exile for criminals, evildoers and unfortunate kings and princes. Instructions were given for centuries for animate and inanimate beings and forest of Soma plantation were given. Royal game sanctuaries reserved for royal hunts were also to be planned. Instructions were laid down for royal hunting forest to be as extensive as possible with only inlet and mostly planted with juicy fruit orchards, fragrant bushes, bowers and shrubs inlaid with ponds. What is interesting is that hunting was permitted only for those animals which were rendered harmless, like tigers and carnivore without claw and teeth. Cow, elephant and calf and elephants, bisons, they were for the ruler's food. Reserve forests capable of yielding forest products were also conserved. Factories for the processing of forest products and forest eating, such products were also planned. In view of the procuring of all kinds of forest produce described elsewhere, one or several forests were specially reserved. Manufacturers to produce commodities from forest produce were also set up. Wild tracks were separated from timber forest. In the extreme limit of the country, elephant forests separated from wild tracks were formed. Public hunting parks were planned on the borders of the state. I will be skipping few things. Strict rules were laid down by Kauṭilya in his Arthashastra if natural resources apart from the need of it were wrought. He explicitly mentioned that a mine laborer who steals mineral products except precious stones shall be punished with a fine of 8 times their value. Any person who steals mineral produce, products or carries on mining operation without license shall be bound with chains and forced to work as a prisoner. Kauṭilya lays on rules not only for land but also for water bodies. It is a departure from the Vedas in the Upanishads where the water bodies were ascribed with spiritual powers. The departure is mainly because the Arthaśāstra deals with the earth in the Arthaśāstra. The superintendent of ocean mines shall attain to the collection of conch shells, diamonds, precious stones, pearls, corals and salt and also regulate the commerce in the above commodity. The Arthaśāstra also give directions towards not only maximizing of profit but also avoiding wastage of commodities. If no profit can be realized by selling the local produce in foreign countries, the merchants has to consider whether any local produce can be profitably bartered for any foreign produce. Then he may send one quarter of his valuable merchandise through safe roads to different markets on land. In view of large profits, he may make friendship with the forest guard, boundary guards and officers in charge of cities and of country parks. He shall take care to secure his treasure and life from danger. If he cannot reach the intended market, he may sell the merchandise free from all dues, or he may take his merchandise to other countries through rivers. We get the first lesson on marketing strategy and minimization of resource wastage in the Arthaśāstra, where the merchant is advised that after having gathered information as to the transaction in commercial towns along the banks of river, he shall transport his merchandise to profitable markets and avoid unprofitable ones. Arthaśāstra also fixes responsibility on the superintendent of forest produce who will collect timber and other products of forest by employing those who guard productive forest. It was his responsibility to not only start productive work in forest but also fix adequate fines and compensations to be levied from those who cause damage to productive forest except in calamities. Kauṭilya paid great attention to public hygiene, which is overlooked in societies even today. Strict enforcements for penalty were there for people who threw dirt in the street, whoever commits nuisance in shrines, water tanks, temples and state buildings. Exceptions were made for such offenses, which were due to medication or disease. To maintain proper sanitation and public health, throwing of karkas in city was also prohibited. I come now to the last part. As the Arthaśāstra underlines the primary importance of artha, that is the material and economic factors, in all possible state activities, it is only natural that it lays considerable stress on the economic importance and resource potential of Dravyavan. Kauṭilya considers that it is possible to plant many material forests in many tracts of land. This may imply that the produce of forest was not located in any fixed and permanent tract. From this one may conclude that the above Kauṭilya dictum implies a conscious effort on the part of administration to conclude that the above part of administration to create new forest for utilizing untapped material resources. In conclusion, it may be said that given the world situation today, where we find overpopulation, rampant killings of animals, clearing of forests to make way for industrialization, the Arthaśāstra gives significant insight in the protection and conservation of the environment, though we find seeds of anthropocentrism in it. Thank you.
It is also important to know that when we organize this program, we are all expected full papers. It is not only sending an abstract, because as per the ICPR framework, you said full paper, basically they can accept, and Namita was the first to send the full paper.
Thank you.
So thanks for the whole support. Now the second part of it, I would be requesting Madhuma to take over the moderation of the questions and summary of the whole session.
Thank you. We have got some questions for Dr. Subhash Sharma. The question is, what do you mean by strong nation and strong corporate?
Well, I think by strong nation, it is understood powerful nation. You are a superpower, or I could say superb power. Kautilya's Arthaśāstra tells us about superb power, not just superpower. Now, what is the difference between superpower and superpower? The superpower is the Y dimension, the goodness dimension, the happiness dimension, and superpower is the X dimension. So the superpower may indulge into colonialism, but the superpower will be very conscious, will not indulge into colonialism and those kinds of things which have happened in modern history. So same thing applies for the corporate. If it is a super corporate, it will not overexploit the environment. Just now we listened about the environment. So that is the basic idea.
Then the person wants more explanation on subversive society and also your idea of nation state.
See, nation state, you divide it into two parts. The nation part and the state part. Then you will get a new kind of a concept. So the nation will have a lot of other dimensions, the spiritual dimension, the cultural dimension, the social dimension. While the state is just the entity, power dimension. So second civic society similarly, the x-axis is the civic and y-axis is the secular. So Ram and the Raja combined together. So the combination of the two, that becomes a new vision for the whole world.
As per your soul theory, how do you relate soil with the soul? And soul does not exist. Do you agree? If not, then why?
Well, I think we are taking very technical definitions of the soil and the soul. Here, for me, it's a very simple definition. Soil means the land, the earth, okay. And soul means the higher order purpose of existence. You know, that is the way I would like to look at it. Ask yourself, is there a higher order purpose of existence in your own life? Or in the life of a nation? Or for the whole world. So what is that? Particularly, so that's the way I would like to do.
There's one questions for Dr. Priya, Vaidya and Dr. Shobhana Joshi. So where does Kauṭilya talk about critical reasoning? How do you generate that interesting steps?
I think in the text there has been a mention of the reasoning, the critical reasoning, and when we talk about philosophy and thinking, there the mention is there. Second thing, how do we generate that critical reasoning? Since due to less time, I think that everyday situations also, when we try to reflect upon the dimension of reasoning, where we, each one of us has some approach about it, whether it is privacy, norms and Aadhaar card, or any other issue if you see, there is lot of this critical realm which emerges. So especially with teachers, as I said, if it is a 6 months program, typically there can be this critical reasoning thing which can be done. While I was trying to design it, I also thought of one particular activity, because we are in a democratic country and where we have parties and we have colors which are associated to parties. So just by showing colors, the opinions which are formed and how this can be looked at from the critical reasoning point of view. It's a little abstract level which I have done. But if I work more, I think I can come up with something more interesting.
So, what do you mean by enlightened leader? That is one question. And then, is ontology more important for consequentialism?
I think the 20 minutes discussion which I did tried to reflect upon the enlightened realm of leadership. And I would also say that it is not just that, but still something further. Because as we look at the realm of enlightened aspect, the word itself, it has its subjective dimension. So it cannot be said, this is it. These are the points and full stop. If you look at the points itself, they have their own subjective realm. So I think personally it is not something just the is, but it's a journey between the is and the or, which is ongoing and ever flourishing.
Training, they can be allowed to parents. What is the qualification and when it will start?
It's a very interesting question. And I thought we would perhaps ask whether such training is required at all. Because as you know, I read it somewhere, a mother is the first teacher and teacher is the second mother of the child. So, although we think that this kind of training is not required, but if we get or equip parents with this kind of training, there's no harm, there's no qualification required. Any mother who is ready to integrate thoughts and who is concerned about generation next. And I don't think the mother is only restricted to one's own family. The mother can also enlighten more mothers. So this can be a kind of a dimension which can grow. Just to share one experience, I was invited at a program where I trained 100 mothers at a school. So there was a survey which was done by a school, I wouldn't name it, but the problem which the school felt was the mothers were not giving adequate things in the tiffin. Like the mothers started giving fast food items in the tiffin. They were not taking appropriate care of the child as it should be. So I was given some points and some training of this sort was given. The workshop went well, as it was well received, etc. But during the feedback session, very good feedback came for the school authorities. One of the mothers said that it's good that you have kept a training program for us. We are really grateful. But we have one suggestion. Child nurturing is not just a mother's job. It is a father's job also. So please give father workshops specially for fathers, because fathers are not at home and they expect the mothers to look after the child. So this was a very interesting insight at that workshop. I think the organizers also took a note, but I didn't get invited for conducting a workshop of ours.
We started it just recently.
But as I have indicated in the paper that environmental concerns were there then also, the gravity of the issues have increased now. Because when we speak about any nation to prosper, one has to work in the framework of environment. When they talk about making reservoirs or talk about making roads, you have to fell down trees. You have to go to different lands. So you have to take, you know, without exploiting the environment, it will not be possible to make any progress. However, the way in which it was done, it was in a very sacred manner. And since the population was less, we didn't find the gravity of the situation.
I would just like to add that whether that was exploitation of nature or whether that was use of nature. You know, without using the nature, no survival is possible, no progress is possible. So all that is there, but progress can be smooth also without exploiting nature. And if we look at Arthaśāstra and the whole emphasis is on enlightened leadership, actually it focuses on the balancing approach. And a leader has to look at the entire situation in such a way that has to balance between the progress which is not exploited. It has to be progress, it has to be the pleasure of the people, but at the same time, non-exploitative, because all the time Kauṭilya is talking about dharma as its foundation. And the enlightened leadership, he specifically mentions Arishadvarga Dhyanina. And when Arishadvarga Dhyanina comes in, all of you know, since you have done it in the first year, the entire text, Arishadvarga Dhyanina means that kama, krodha, lobha, madha, moha, matsara, everything should be under control. And moha should be under control, it means that the model of the progress has to be non-exploited. So exploitation of nature will be absolutely absent. Because the transformation is not only of a leader, but the transformation of the population also is expected. Kauṭilya is saying that why a leader should be a leader like a Rajarshi, enlightened leader, because the enlightened leader will teach. The leader will be like a teacher, and then Praja also will try to follow the steps of the enlightened leader. So I think that a very close relation between nature and human persons, the human society, is depicted here.
So this session had there is one question, but the handwriting is not legible. So I will request the concerned person to contact Dr. Priya Vaidya later on, and then get answers to the query. So there are three papers in this session. Dr. Subhash which were excellent and were thought-provoking, very insightful also. Dr. Subhash Sharma has compared and contrasted historical and contemporary. And he had the Kauṭilyan model, the Gandhi model, the Modi model, and how has context changed from establishment of the kingdom to the liberation of kingdom. And then he also coined a term which is sacro civic society, which is the Indian model of governance. So he also underlined the dimension of socialism and capitalism as the head dimension. And the sarkasat, the sarkarikas, monkey bat are the head and heart dimension. So that is the difference between the Indian way of looking towards government. So also he has quite interesting terms like national development, international aspirations, etc. And gave a new meaning to Arthashastra as the earth shastra, which is also very notable. Thank you very much for your valuable presentation. Next we have Dr. Priya Vaidya. So her paper was on enlightened leadership, and it was an application-based paper, as she has said. So we are not just thinking of armchair philosophy, but how can philosophy be a part of the field? So that is something which she has brought out. And so she has thought about the nature of an enlightened leader and creating a grid which is oneself, other, beyond. And in this way, she has also thought of, I would like to have some silence. And she has also thought of creating training programs for critical reasoning, how to look within rather than without. So that is how to have vivek in this present scenario. So she spoke about knowledge, how knowledge is not mere information, but it should get translated into wisdom and innovation. So these are the valuable points which she has expressed. Then we have a paper on environmental perspective of Kauṭilya. And I like the approach of Dr. Namita, and that is of the anthropocentric approach, which she has in that entire outlook she has interpreted Kauṭilya. So giving mere data of how Kauṭilya was aware about the environment was a simple job, but analyzing the data and interpreting it in one particular perspective was something which is unique, and that is what I liked about her presentation. So she actually connected the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change with the Kauṭilya text, and how can Kauṭilya text be insightful in the present scenarios. So there was the concept of protection of animals. And you can add in their paper also that one of the Ashokan edicts gives a list of animals which were declared to be protected. And so hunting was banned. So as in the present times we have endangered species and banning of hunting and paying special care towards them. Similarly, in those times also, there was a concept like banning of hunting of certain animals, and the list was quite exhaustive. So you can also refer to that. And even she highlighted the water issues. So how can there be water reservation and protection and conservation of water? And this is very significant in the present times when Maharashtra experienced one of the worst droughts. And the present call of the chief ministers of Jalayukta Shiva. So in that context, the points which she has made are very vital. So she has also mentioned about corruption and marketing strategies, and also public hygiene, which was discussed in her paper, and especially in the light of Swachh Bharat. So all the three papers were really interesting. They really contributed to the knowledge on Arthaśāstra, and I congratulate all the paper readers for this, and thank you for permitting me to be the chairperson of this session.
We had a request by our scholar who is on the way to Mumbai, Jaydevi ma'am, and she has to leave tomorrow. Is it okay we can take your first paper in the morning? Yeah, because what has happened is that we wanted to accommodate, but the good part is that we are before time also today. We're supposed to find up at 6. So we will take this up first thing in your morning before.
Yes, no problem.
Because the session was post lunch, but she had to leave. So we will accommodate in the morning. Thank you for that. So I think with that, we are 15 minutes ahead of time today. And hopefully we start again. But before we find up, two things. Number one, please do have a look at the book exhibition that's been there. Not for the book exhibition, you can actually buy it also. And if you are Motilal Varanasi Das, one of the biggest contribution of Motilal Varanasi Das to the Kauṭilya field is the R.P. Kamle publication. A very famous Kauṭilya Arthaśāstra book. The publishers told me that book is always out of stock, which is a good problem. That means people are buying it. Even now they don't have it, but they say if you want to order it, they will be able to deliver it to you. The other books on Indian culture, Indology, is all available, as they've been phenomenal work for so many years. And we are proud as Mumbai University that R.P. Kamle sir has been part of our university, scholar of Sanskrit itself, and he's done a wonderful contribution to the kind of a subject that we're doing. So please do take your time out, look out for the books of your interest in Indology. And before we wind up, and Chetan gives this closing information. Subhash ji wanted to actually talk about two of his books and give one to the chairperson. Yeah.
the valuable contribution of Mumbai University to the field of Arthaśāstra is that before Kauṭilya took over Kamlesh's edition, it was Mumbai University who published Kauṭilya Arthaśāstra by R.T. Kamlesh in 3 volumes. And still those old volumes are available, say same one are there, but they are available at a very throwaway price in the Mumbai University publication department, which is at the Fort University. So suppose if you feel that the edition of Motilal is quite costly, you can go in for that publication also, which is one and the same.
I got into Motilal Vanasi first, we know where the source is coming from. So, thank you so much, Madhuri ma'am. So, I would like Subhash sir to just talk about the two books. First, I would like to present this book, the New Arthasastra, the one about which I talked to you. Those who are interested can download it from the book is available on ResearchGate. So, very easy to download it. Second is my recent book, 2018 publication. So it was very recently released. This is titled as Conversations on Remaking of Managers. What I taught was actually an idea which is on the remaking of managers. Because right now the managers are mostly the Western mindset of a particular profit-driven. There is no social interest, there is no spiritual dimension. So we need a holistic kind of a thinking even for the corporate world. So some of those ideas which I talked about are also there. This is basically a conversation. It is a conversation between me and Dr. Daniel, who is from Goa, and we have been talking about some of these thoughts which are related to corporates, organizations, looking at the society, and many of those dimensions in a different perspectives. So I am really very, very happy to present this to Dr. Radhakrishnan.
One last question, Shukla Joshi ma'am. The timing for tomorrow is 9 to 10, but if we can start by 9:30, all of you can come by 9 have the breakfast. We have a longer time.
Thanks. Yeah. And so I request both the chairpersons to hand over the transmission certificates to the leaders. First to Dr. Sharma. Chairpersons for giving your time, and they are home family members only, but still they are very busy.